Welcome back, students, for the very same session of our study plan. Now you're going to study the chapters, or in which order you're going to study the chapters. Okay, first always start with mathematics. Okay, always start with maths first, and then once you are a little ahead from the school in maths, then you can start science. Okay, and once you're a little ahead from the school in science and also maths, then you will start social science. So in that way, you must always follow. In maths, which chapters you start first? Okay, first you'll start the real numbers, very basic. Okay, your chapter 1. Okay, after that you'll also go with polynomials, and then chapter 3. These three are in the algebra. So actually, I also prefer you start with algebra first, because algebra is the mother of all maths. If you know algebra well, you can actually perform better in maths, because algebra is going to be like, it's going to play a role in every single subject or every single part of the maths that you're going to study. Okay, so once you complete these three chapters, I think you have done good with algebra, I mean enough for the time being. So you can start with triangles. Triangles is a very huge chapter, it's extremely big. So last year you already come across something called similarity, I mean something called congruence, right? You have come across triangle and its congruence, but this year you are going to study similarity. That is a new thing. It is similar to congruence, but here it's not just the sizes that's going to be the same. Sides might be unequal, but the ratio of those sides would be the same in two similar triangles. That's what you're going to study in this year. I'll have a look. If I'm able to, then I'll teach you the entire chapters later on. But for now, just keep in mind, this triangle is very much similar to what you've already studied before. Okay? So for that, you should be able to cope up. See, your pair of linear equation in two variables is also very similar to your last year's question, last year's chapter itself. But this time you have simultaneous equations. That is, you have two equations solving both the equations algebraically. And polynomials, of course, you know, that's very simple. Okay, you are going to study the same concept in a little higher standard. You're going to study a very important concept called the zeros. Zeros you already studied last year. Okay, what are zeros? The solutions where the LHS is going to be some equation and the RHS is going to be zero. So that particular solution of a polynomial where the equation would turn into or equate into zero, that solution is called a zero of a polynomial. So that you're going to study extensively in this chapter. Real numbers, you all know, there is nothing to teach about that. But here you're going to study two new things, that is Euclid's division lemma and the fundamental theorem of arithmetic. Both their applications. The application of Euclid's division lemma is your algorithm. And the application of fundamental theorem of arithmetic is the algorithm of arithmetic. That is what you're going to study with the prime factorization method. So these are the two new concepts that you're going to study in the real numbers. And also you'll study how to prove that if a given number is irrational. Once you complete these four chapters, I think you're done with maths for the time being. If you have time, you could go with the other chapters too. But for now, if I were you, I would study science. Okay? So yay. Once you come to science, that's pretty easy. So in science, you will always and always start with the first chapter, because this is the basic of your chemistry. Something without which your entire 10th standard chemistry is going to ruin. So this chapter must be concentrated to the extreme peak of it, or else you're going to ruin your entire 10th standard, as I told you. Because here you get into something called equation, and you're hearing this word equation for the first time in your life. So you must be very accurate. Okay, and in naming the equations, parts of equations, balancing the equations. Balancing is extremely important. If you do not understand balancing, do not move into the next concept. Always complete balancing to the greatest extent. Okay, so that you don't have confusion throughout the 10th standard. Okay, so along with that, you will also come across types of equations, which is not that important for your remaining chapters. In fact, you're going to study some more types. Okay, here you mainly have, I think you have oxidation, that is redox, okay, oxidation reduction, you have combination, decomposition, displacement and double displacement. But later on, you'll also come across a substitution reaction, addition reaction, okay, and combustion reaction. All these you're going to come across mainly in your carbonyl compounds. There's a whole lot of new equations over there. So for that, you must never, don't get panic, but the thing is, that is not supposed to be given utmost importance for your entire 10th standard. So mainly concentrate on balancing the equations. Once you complete the first chapter, second chapter is pretty easy. You can do it well. Okay. Second chapter is acid bases and salts. There's nothing complex in this. You've already studied all the stuff. You just understand the chemical properties of acids and bases. That is the main point over here. Chemical properties and physical. That you must know the difference. In physical properties, you have the sour taste of acid turns blue litmus red, and then your bases are bitter, turns red litmus blue. All that stuff is your physical. But in the chemical properties, you have a few reactions that you need to by heart and remember with the balanced equations. So that is very, very important in this chapter, but it's pretty simple, okay? You can complete it in a day or two. Always try to complete chapters in less than 5 days. Never exceed any chapter. In fact, for this, that is your acid bases and salts, I prefer you do it within 2 days. 2 days. This chapter you can spend up at least 4 days. This you can spend 3 days. This can be done in 4 days. Your third chapter is very, very big. Pair of linear equation in two variables. It is extremely big chapter, so you can at least use 10 days over. No, that it really doesn't matter. Triangles is also a very big chapter, so you can spend some time. Say you do 1 week. Okay, 1 week. That would be enough. But this chapter, there's your pair of linear equation in two variables, being big, you can spend time. This being a little bigger, you can. Okay. So the science chapters so far so good, you have done good. Then start with physics. And when I'm talking about physics, I literally mean the practical approach over physics where you calculate concepts. Because that is very, very important, and most of the students find it very, very difficult. So I'm gonna give you some tips and tricks on how to do that too. Okay? So for you in physics, if we talk about the physics part, after your acid bases and salts, you will always start with electricity. Okay? Because this has got a lot of application. Application in the sense it's got calculations, or what you say, numericals. See, in physics, for 10th standard, it's not difficult. In fact, you have only two chapters with numericals. You have electricity in your first term. Okay, and in the second term, I think, So in the second term, you have light reflection and refraction. Electricity in the first term, light reflection and refraction in the second term, where you have numericals. You also have magnetic effect of electric current. Okay, here you have magnetism. But that does not got to do anything with numericals, calculation. Here, for light in the second term, you also have human eye in the colorful world, but there you don't have to do extensive calculations. You have one or two, but that's easy, right? It's just power and Lenz formula, you can use it. When we talk about physics in general, what are the stuff that you need to give importance to? First, definitions. Definitions are not difficult, right? But in physics, it's very, very difficult. Why I refer difficulty level in the definition of physics? Because there, the definition is not common. It's not the thing that you always come across. For example, if I say, let us take an example from your textbook itself. Okay, let us take electricity. Easy chapter. We've already discussed upon that. So, why am I spending an embarrassing amount of time searching for the chapter? So, see, if you look at your page number 199, which actually comes after your light reflection and refraction, but it's very, very important. Okay, let us talk about potential difference. What is potential difference? It is a little difficult to understand. Potential difference represented by V, volts, unit. What is it? See, in physics, you just cannot say lengthy, long stories that potential difference is a charge which brings about the charge in the current which makes the electrons move or which generates electricity. It's not the right thing. I'll give you a very simple tip to give definition to anything in physics. If you talk about potential difference, then look at the formula. It says W upon Q, work done upon unit charge. That's it. I set the definition in front of you right now. Okay, I'll give you another clue. What you need to do is always look at the definition. If the definition is a fraction, okay, if it is a fraction, okay, if look at the formula. If the formula is a fraction, then equate the denominator to 1. So what do you call it? Unit. Okay. Always in fraction, you say something per something. For example, 5 rupees per kg, or say 5 liters per centimeter cube. Okay, so that way you're going to name, right, in the fractions. So what you need to do is look at the denominator, equate it to 1. So that will become unit, per unit. Look at the numerator, it is work. So potential difference is work done by what? By the electrons, or you can also call it as electricity. Okay, so work done by current, you can also write it as I current, anything. So work done, let me consider a simple statement, current. So work done by the current in a unit charge is called potential difference. You get to know how I defined it. Numerator done, okay, numerator on the thing that is going to apply on. For example, if it is work, then work done on what is the work done? On the current. So work done on the current per the denominator, that is per unit charge. Okay, that is your potential difference. You can add some more decorations over there to make the definition look more interesting. You could call it potential difference is a unit of work done per unit current charge, okay, in a given time, or it is a ratio of work done per unit charge represented by the letter V, or the unit or the SI unit of your say potential difference is volts. Okay, you can add up the definition, you can extend the definition to a great extent. For example, a formal definition would be potential difference is a work done on the current per unit charge, and its SI unit is V, which represents voltage. So that is what I wrote for my exam. So in that way, if you are able to confide with the definitions, that's going to make it, it's going to be a huge change for you. And then after definitions, okay, you have mastered the definitions. Now you must know all the formulas, that's a must. Formulas are a must. Every single formula given to you in the textbook, and not just the formula, it's derivation. Most of the students by heart the formula, but in the exam you are also asked the derivation. Okay, so you must know the derivation, how that formula is bottom. Derivation is easy to understand if you look at it step by step. Look very slowly, don't hurry up. Or if you are not getting it into your head, then try to write it. Okay, writing will help you out get the formulas much better. So derivation is also important, along with the formulas and its corollaries. See, the corollaries are nothing but like you have a formula, say potential difference is work done by unit charge. So I can derive the charge as I first bring it to the LHS, that becomes VQ upon W, so Q becomes W upon V. That is a corollary. Corollary of work can be given as VQ. Okay, so with this very formula given to me, I derive two more formulas. Okay, in that way you must know the corollaries of every single formula. You must know that if you're going to transpose some letter, you're going to get something else, because it's not that every time you'll be asked to find the potential difference. They might give you the potential difference, ask you to find the work. So you must know that. And if you know the definition, then even if the question is twisted, you will be able to answer it. Okay, get the theory well. Physics is not only calculation, it is also about theory. So get your theory to the foundation level. Also know your previous classes thing, because if I talk about current, then you might not even know what is current. So that was learned by you in class 8. Okay, so you must never forget the foundation classes. Formulas, their derivations and corollaries, and then your numericals. If you know these two, you should be able to solve numericals, but every single attempt is your fresh attempt in physics, because questions are not going to be like maths. They won't give you the given two units and you'll not be asked to find the third unit. Okay, so that's what happens in maths. You'll be given x and y, calculate z, something like that. But in physics, it's going to be totally different. They might not even give you one unit. So you might have to apply 4 to 5 formulas to just calculate the asked value. Okay, so you must know what formula to apply, when to apply. For that, you must solve numerous problem of numericals. So that's why I told you, look at your NCERT questions, that is textbook and examples. Example in physics, you get plenty of numericals, along with that your exemplar problems. That will give you enough practice and you're good to go for your exam. Okay, and the other books, the Oswald or whatever I asked you previously. So if you solve these many, physics wouldn't be that difficult for you, because physics is something which got to do a lot of numerical stuff, which becomes pretty easy for you. Theory, anyhow, you can master it. Always, while studying science, keep biology for the last, because that is something where you need to by heart stuff. Okay, and theory is very simple. You need to know the logic behind it. In the textbook, not all the questions have been given with the logic. So what you need to do is, at times you will have to look at the other sources. That's why I prefer you use some softwares, or you use some other reference books like Pradeep, or some elaborated one, not the smaller one than the textbook. Textbook is very small for you in biology. You must have some more stuff. Or look at the internet. Google searching is the best stuff. You can, you know, you'll get the answers for everything over there. But you must know technically why is it. For example, I'll just give you a quick example. See, in biology, you had life processes where you had urine formation, right? Urine formation. It was given that in the second step, you have something called reabsorption, where the required salts and the minerals are reabsorbed. But I was wondering, how can that be possible? For example, see, here you have your Bowman's capsule, okay? And this is your nephron, one unit of your nephron. From here, the capillaries exert pressure, okay, and your blood enters the Bowman's capsule. It passes through this. It goes to your loop of Henle. Okay, in the Henle's loop, you have the reabsorption. In this particular area, you have the reabsorption, right? This particular area, this area. So I was wondering, how is it possible? Reabsorption, in a sense, this has to be porous. But if this material or this tube is porous, then even the unwanted material might flow into the pure blood. But then I understood, this part is surrounded by your blood vessels. You also have blood vessels coming from over here, okay, and they enter the Bowman's capsule. Okay, you have blood vessels also over here. So these blood vessels, what they do is, they intersect the loop of Henle. Also, along with that, due to pressure difference, amount of concentration, for example, these blood vessels have very low amount of concentration of purity. Okay, they have more impurities, whereas this has a very high amount of impurities and a very low amount of purities. And you know, every single content moves from a region of high concentration to a region of low concentration. Hence, the purities, which is very high in the loop of Henle, moves into the blood vessels, which has a very low concentration of impurities. Okay, that is the salts and minerals. So in that way, you must know the logic behind your theory, because theory itself is not going to help you in your exams. In biology, the very first chapter given to you is the life processes, which is actually a foundation or the base chapter for your next upcoming. Okay, in the second term also, your first chapter is reproduction, which is also a base for your genetics. So you must know biology, go through the order of your textbook. That is the best given order. So once you complete one chapter in physics, two chapters in chemistry, then you can start with one chapter in biology. That will help you for your term one. And then start metals and non-metals. That is your chapter three. You are done good with biology, okay? And then you also done good with physics. Then start metals and non-metals. After you do the metals and non-metals, then follow the order of your textbook. It really doesn't matter. But remember, carbon and its compounds, periodic classification of elements, all these come in your second term. Whereas control and coordination comes in your first term. Okay? And control and coordination is very much related to your reproduction. It is also related to life processes. Okay, because every single thing that happens over here, in control and coordination, you have especially a point where you study about hormones at the end. And this part is all about your reproduction. Okay, so these two are related. And reproduction is all about genetics. And your hormones is all about life processes. So in that way, you must follow your order, where everything is related. Life process, and then control and coordination, reproduction and heredity and evolution. That will give you a quick chain of what is going to happen. It is in order. In order. Okay? That's how you do biology. And then chemistry, the remaining chapters you can go good. Second term, always start with your carbon and its compounds, because that is a very big, huge and difficult chapter where you need to remember a lot of things. And this is actually giving you a foundation for your organic chemistry. And if you know some boys who are in 11th or 12th standard, you will know their difficulties, because they might have ignored the carbon and its compounds, and later on when they go to the organic chemistry, they are going to find difficulties, because carbon and its compounds, especially your hydrocarbons, that is only about organic chemistry, and that is very huge in your 11th and 12th syllabus. In your 11th and 12th chemistry, around 60% is organic. Okay? And then remaining you are around 30% is your inorganic chemistry, and the remaining 20% is approximately your physical. So 11th and 12th. So for that you must know a proper base in your 10th standard itself. So pay attention with your carbon and its compounds. Especially if you are going for the competitive exams, you must know those chapters well. In your second term also for physics, start with light, because human eye is also related to light. Okay, and once you do your electricity, you can also study your magnetic effects of electric current, because that is also very much similar. You have sources of energy also in physics, but this physics chapter sources of energy is more like biology. Okay, and there is no calculations, no numericals at all. It's all about theory and your energy resources. So it's almost biology, and you know, you can mix up biology and physics in that chapter, so it's very easy. In the second term, your scoring chapters would be our environment and management of natural resources. Both you have already studied. There is nothing new over here. You already know in the environment, you only have food chains and food webs, which is a little different. Okay, so you have already studied everything over here, just recapping stuff and learning it for the value based questions, because in your board exam you're going to have value based questions only from these two chapters, environment and resources, natural resource management. So that is the main part where you can also expect 4 to 5 mark questions. So pay attention, that is actually a scoring chapter, you are not learning anything new. So you can do it very quickly. You can do all these chapters, even your sources of energy, in just one day each, all these chapters. So that will cover up pretty much your science. Maths, I already gave you, I have given you the idea of how you're going to proceed. Okay, all the geometry of your mathematics will be done in the last. Geometry is because it is a scoring chapter firstly, and you can do it very quickly. For example, your constructions and everything, very very easy. You already studied that. That is where you only do the application part, and that too can be done very quickly if you understood the concept. But that is where you must maintain the neatness. For neatness in the exam, you just can't do it quickly. You have to do it slowly, though you know the question very well. Okay, in your maths, mensuration this year, that is your surface areas and volumes and areas related to circle, has got very big calculations. So pay attention on the calculations too. And the trigonometry, which is a very new concept for you guys, it is very easy. go very slowly. First, you must know the trigonometric ratios. There are many methods to remember that, but what I use is, you have many. You have Pandit Badri Prasad Har Har Bole. Perpendicular upon hypotenuse, base upon hypotenuse, perpendicular upon base, sine cos tan. So that can be used, or you can use osha osha chota. It's available in the internet, you can have a look. So sine is opposite upon hypotenuse, cos is adjacent upon hypotenuse, tan is opposite upon adjacent. It just tells you what kind of a method your teacher is using. If he uses the word perpendicular, base and hypotenuse, then you follow this method. If he uses the words opposite, adjacent and hypotenuse, use this, because both are same. In a triangle, right angle triangle with one angle given as theta, the opposite is actually your perpendicular, the adjacent is actually your base, and hypotenuse is hypotenuse. So both are applicable, but if you are using the terms perpendicular and base, use this formula, and if you are using the term opposite and adjacent, use this. Okay, in the textbook they are using the opposite and adjacent words, the terminology. So I'm going to use this while I'm teaching. Okay, and your calculation part in the areas related to circle and the surface areas and volumes is very big, so pay attention on that too. Logical thinking is highly used in circles, where you need to think every single question logically. Even your coordinate geometry requires some amount of thinking. Some applications of trigonometry, very useful. You must know how to picturize stuff. Okay? And statement problems in your polynomials, pair of linear equations in two variables, and quadratic equations. Very, very important. Solve number of questions, you can do it well. You can master it pretty easily. Okay, probabilities, once again, statistics and probability are your scoring chapters. In term 1, statistics, and term 2, probability. But statistics requires a lot of new formulas. You always used to study median as the middle term, that's it. And say mean as sum of all observation divided by total number of observation. But this year, you're going to study sigma fx, okay, sigma f dx, so all these kind of formulas. Okay, summation. So all the summation formulas you must know very well. You can also concentrate on that. But if you know the formulas, it's a scoring chapter. You will not have any graph in second term. Okay, in the second term, the chapters for you in the second term is quadratic equations, no graph. Arithmetic progression, no graph. Coordinate geometry, though it's all about graphs, but you don't have any graphs. You only have three formulas: distance formula, section formula, and your areas related to triangles. So you'll not have any graphs over there. And applications of trigonometry, naturally no graphs. Circles, no graphs. Constructions, no. Areas related to circles, no. Surface areas and volumes, no. And probability, no. So you'll not have any graphs in your second term. In your first term, you're going to have graphs either from polynomials, okay, where you are studying the parabolas to calculate the number of zeros. This particular parabola has two zeros. That kind of parabolas. Or you might have it in pair of linear equations in two variables, where you're making two graphs, okay, in a single axis, and the point of intersection is your solution. Okay, so that is also useful. So yeah, that is also covering up your mathematics. In the next module, I will be talking a little about languages and social science, and how to manage those subjects. It's going to be very short because I can't teach everything over there. It's just up to you, but I'm going to teach you how to manage those stuff easily. Thank you.